Hi guys, I'm David Winning. I'm a director and a producer in the film business. I've done about 40 movies and I've worked on 29 or 30 different TV series, and it all started at CSIF for me.
Let's do it!
Tell us what you saw, man.
He's blind.
Oh. Sorry, dude!
The original founding members back in the late 70s. And I think the biggest inspirational story that I have is just kind of the way I got started, because I was just literally a nobody from Northwest Calgary trying to make movies in my backyard. And now I'm somehow managed to keep a career going for, 40 years. So that's good, because if I can do it, anybody can do it. Okay, well, in this scene, you're playing a down and out farmer.
Okay.
So basically, I've been a director for a long time. So basically what that means is that you're down.
Okay.
And you're out.
Oh, and out. Okay, I can try that.
I've been directing for probably 40 years. Managed to survive in a business that's pretty rough. I've done all sorts of stuff. I've directed about 40 movies. A lot of movies for the Hallmark Channel recently. I've done a lot of Christmas movies in the last 5 years. So I guarantee if you've seen any Christmas movies, you have me to blame. And I've done a ton of science fiction. I worked on Stargate Atlantis, directed Andromeda with Kevin Sorbo for 5 seasons, and Earth Final Conflict, and on and on and on. And I've done monster movies. I've done kids series for Nickelodeon. I've kind of done a bit of everything. I have a kind of the corny story about getting a Super 8 movie camera when I was 10. My dad got me a camera. And so I started making movies when I was 10, and I had so much fun doing it, I thought, I've got to find a way to make a living out of this. So I was making films through high school. I ended up making what they called back then a special drama project in grade 12. I made a short film and I got credit for it, which kind of got me through high school. So I guess I did one of the first productions at CSIF. It was a short film called Sequence, and that was kind of how I got into the film business, was just making this film. So CSIF was very important to me back then because I didn't have any access to equipment. And then I was just tootling around trying to raise money to go to film school in my early 20s, and I ended up having this brainstorm one day that I was going to make my first feature. So, crazy me, told my dad, you know all that money we've saved for film school? We're going to actually go buy film stock. It's back when you actually had film. And I shot my first feature called Storm in the summer of 83. It took me most of my 20s to finish. And basically, I guess, in hindsight, what I did was I created my own film school, because I ended up directing and writing and producing, and I'm even in it. I acted in it, and so that was a riot. That's kind of how I got into the business, was making that film.
At the movies, a local filmmaker is sending his latest effort to France to be screened at the prestigious Cannes Film Festival. David Winning has just completed his second film. It's a mystery thriller called Storm.
For two students, it began on campus as a game.
Well, say something. Jesus is real.
For three men, it began 38 years ago as murder.
Yeah, so that was a riot. That's kind of how I got into the business, was making that film. And I thought, kid from nowhere in Western Canada making movies in his backyard, and I finally got this feature made, and I figured if I didn't sell it, that would be the end of my film career. So
got another thing coming if you think I'm just gonna pack up and leave.
Don't cause trouble, Bert. It's for the best.
But we sold it, and I ended up you just kind of drift around in the film business. That got me into the Directors Guild of Canada, and one day somebody was sick on a TV series in Toronto, so they looked through the Directors Guild and they said, Winning, sounds positive, let's hire this guy. So they flew me down to Toronto, and I started directing episodes of a series called Friday the 13th for Paramount, which is kind of a syndicated midnight series. It was quite strange going from a crew of like 10 people to a crew of about 100 down in Toronto on Friday the 13th, and I had no clue what I was doing, so I was kind of learning by flying by the seat of my pants. And the main difference between independent filmmaking and working for Hallmark Channel or any of these other studios, obviously, is they've got tons more money and you have so much less to worry about. I spent most of my 20s just trying to raise money to make movies. And so the transition was nice for me, was I didn't have to be raising the money anymore. And also, directing TV was really lucrative, obviously. So I could pay the rent and feed myself. And then, like they say, that kind of leads to everything else, I did a lot of television series. I worked for Cannell a lot in Vancouver in the 90s. I did a series called Street Justice, which I think was my second series. And then the whole time I was trying to get independent features still going in Calgary. So in the early 90s, we did my second feature, which was called Killer Image, Michael Ironside and Emmett Walsh.
Framed me. He has pictures of me with my hands around her neck.
Wrong pictures, Max.
So that was cool. And one thing leads to another. And if you can survive long enough, you end up with a long filmography. Resume, I've kind of done a bit of everything. Summer of 1979, way back when, 40 plus years ago, that I think it was probably a dozen people in town just kind of got together. It was more or less a film club, really. Andy Jeremko, who's a picture of him on the wall, was one of the original members, and a bunch of other folks. And it wasn't really formal or anything, and I was, but you know, we met, we were like film fanatics, and so that's kind of how it began. And now you guys have this nice new facility, which is very cool, but I'm very jealous. We didn't have near this kind of equipment you guys seem to have now, and or the space, so that's cool. But and that summer happened to be when I was doing my first short, which was called Sequence, which kind of got adopted as the first society's film. I mean, I was going to make the film anyway, but I was happy to include the folks there, and so some of them worked on it as volunteers. And then Sequence was, you know, short films are tricky because they're hard to sell, but I ended up selling it to Canon International in the States, and they released it as a pre-feature short in theaters. It was shot on 16 millimeter and they blew it up to 35 millimeter. So I guess it was a success story in a sense, but it was us just kind of getting our feet wet, trying to get into the business and see if we could make anything that anybody wanted to see.
Well, I guess you better go, huh? Where's the road? Right here? You almost made it.
So that was fun. That was the first film, and then I guess you guys have been through many different forms over the years, but it's kind of neat that it's hung on, and I'm proud to have been an original member, which is great. They've just given me a little tour of this place. This CSIF now, you guys are really lucky. We never had anything like this. We never had the vast equipment you've got in the back. No computer stuff, no editing equipment and stuff, and this is a blast. If I was starting over again, I would be like knocking down the front door to get in here to work here. So you guys have got it good. We had like an empty theater and a coffee machine, and you know, when we started out, it was just kind of scrape together anything you can. So obviously somebody's doing something right in the organization. The original CSIF was in the Unitarian Church on 16th Avenue in the basement.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
What was really weird is that was where I got my first job in the film business, because it used to be Thunder Road Sound Studios.
Yeah,
and they used
yeah.
to do all the, I was like the mag loader. I'd load all the sound stuff for the different reels.
Oh yeah.
That's how I started. And then going back there was very weird, because it's like, this is my first job in the business. I was 17 and I was loading dubber loaders. People don't even know what those are now, because we used to have, you know, the magnetic tape doing this, the sound linked up to stuff. So
yeah. And my first, yeah, I think they were just on their way up to the barracks. We were still at the
upstairs. Oh, I forgot about the barracks. See, I forgot about the barracks.
Yeah,
I was thinking, because it was CSIF there, and I just didn't know where else. You guys, how many, you must have, what, 10?
Yeah, the basement, and then for sure upstairs on 4th Street. That was my first interaction.
Don't even remember.
And I think
It's the old Y building we were at for.
Yeah, we moved from the barracks. I think they convinced us to move to the barracks.
The barracks was before.
At the in the early 90s.
Yeah.
And then yeah, and then we
because we shot
yeah.
a film at the barracks. I think when you guys were still there. The
yeah.
What was it called? One of our own. One of the Michael Ironside movies shot out at the barracks.
Oh yeah, yeah.
Right when they just when they were demolishing everything, yeah. We used all their tanks and all their. And they literally drove them off set and put them in trucks and took them up to Edmonton, I think. Because they took everything apart. But I'm just, it's kind of cool to think 45 plus years or whatever later that it's still going concern. Because we never thought it was going to, we never thought it was going to last 5 years when we started out. But it was just a whole bunch of people that really wanted to make movies. And this was a place to get equipment so that you could get your hands on stuff and get things done. We all start like that, right? You just make movies and you get big dreams and you think, I don't want a 9-to-5. This is literally how my career happened. I didn't want a 9-to-5 job. So I basically turned my career, which started at CSIF, into my hobby into a career. Turned my hobby into a career.
Yeah, I guess.
Forget your list. Ask me something you want to. Ask me something you want to know. You're making your own movies, right?
Yeah, I am. I guess my biggest thing in sort of where I am in my career is how to make the transition from doing shorts to doing features. And
great question. Yeah. That's a great question, actually. You know, one of the reasons that Sequence was so important to me, and being my first short, and you know, the society's first short, was I eventually got this idea 3 or 4 years later, as I said, when I was starting to do Storm in the early 80s, I thought, because when you're a kid in the prairies here and you think, how am I ever going to make a feature film? But I literally thought, well, if you know, a feature film is just like five shorts connected together, and I've already done one short. So I kind of fooled myself into thinking I can make a feature film. Just it's going to take a little longer, but it's basically short films connected. So that was how I fooled myself into making Storm. But I mean, you really, when you're starting out, you really have to be naive, because I think if you really think about the obstacles, I was pretty young too. I mean, Storm I shot when I was 22. Directed when I was 22, and I finished it when I was 26. So most of my 20s spent making this one movie. And that's kind of how I made the transition, because I just thought, you know, there's really no difference other than length between short films and feature films. And you're trying to get to that magical, you know, 90 minutes or whatever it is, so you can say, oh, I'm a feature filmmaker, you know. And when we finished Storm in 87, it was 78 minutes long. And I was so naive, I thought, you know, people are gonna buy this. And so we shopped it all over the world, and I finally got a sort of a inkling of interest from the Canon group again, the same guys that did all the Stallone movies and Chuck Norris movies in the 80s. And they said, yeah, we'll buy it, kid, we'll buy it. And I thought, oh my God, I made a sale. And then they found out how long it was, and they immediately canned the deal. And I quickly, because I was thinking on my feet, I thought, give me some of the money in advance and I'll go out and shoot extra minutes to try and get it up to 90 minutes. So in the winter of 87, we went out and shot an additional, got all the people back together and wrote a little bit more in the script, and we ended up shooting another 12 or 15 minutes to add to the movie. So the deal went through. It's kind of funny. I thought how brave I was to just boldly say, let's just shoot more of the movie. So the original version of Storm is about 20 minutes shorter than what people see that got released. But for better or for worse, there was lots of good things in it, but I think it kind of slowed it down a little bit. It changed the pace, obviously, trying to crack open a finished movie and add story to it. One of the things I was going to tell you, Troy, was, you know, people ask me what's the best way to get started in the film business? And the thing is, if people are trying to be directors, I always say, you know, sometimes shooting a short film, or certainly shooting a feature film, is just too much. It's too much of an obstacle for people. So I say, well, if you have a feature film you want to make, go out and make the short, like the trailer for the film you don't have enough money to make, and impress people with that, right? So, and it's also a great calling card for being a director, and it teaches you a lot too. So if I were doing Storm again nowadays, I wouldn't have gone and shot the whole thing. I probably would have just tried to shoot a 2-minute sample or something out in the woods with some friends to get some interest, and then sometimes doing that, you can get into these, you know, GoFundMe programs where you can actually raise money based on your little 2-minute trailer and actually get people to help you make the movie. But I did it with all my school funds that I didn't go to USC with. So I didn't get to go to film school. When I started out, we were actually still shooting film, and I remember on TV series sitting beside the camera and watching the actors, and the camera's right here and you can hear the film churning through the camera. And that's how I really date myself, because of course that doesn't happen anymore. I haven't shot film now in 15 or 20 years. I think the digital explosion that's happened in the industry has been incredible. We kind of scoffed at it when it came out because, you know, there's certain directors like Tarantino who refuse to shoot digital. They want to stay with film, and I can totally understand that. But the advances that have happened in digital stuff and 8K and 4K, and it's just unbelievable. I mean, to think, you know, when I was a kid starting out, to think you could go to like a, I don't have Future Shop anymore, what's an electronics store and get a camera for, you know, say under $2,000 or $1,500 that would produce broadcast quality stuff. It just blows my mind. I mean, that was just something you couldn't have access to when I was, I mean, I was just basically trying to get the movies made, and you know, you couldn't, like nowadays with digital, you just roll a camera. And back then it was like, you could only shoot a certain amount of film. I had like a 3-to-1 ratio. And if I shot more than 3 takes of anything on Storm, for example, I was gonna run out of film because I only had a certain amount of film to make the whole movie. The most important thing I think is getting access to equipment when you're trying to make movies, but equally important is just the connections and the people that you make and the people that help you along. Because I mean, I'm big time director now, but I would have been nowhere without hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of crew people and the relationships that you build over the years and stuff, because you can't make movies by yourself. I tried to, but you really need help. And I think CSIF offers people a great social place to get together and meet friends and make movies together. I think it's really important to promote yourself. It's very hard to do that because we're Canadian and we're incredibly polite. You know, how do you get a Canadian to apologize? Punch him in the face. It's not a kind of culture that we grew up in where we're promoting. And you really have to kind of not take no for an answer when you're raising money and trying to get movies made. And so I would say to people, just don't give up. Trying to have the American attitude where you just kind of, you have a vision and you're just gonna push for it. Don't be a jerk ever, but don't be afraid to have a few doors slammed in your face. I think when I did Storm, my first feature, it was, I think I have a file of about 190 rejection letters before we ever sold it. And when I was 26, 27, you're young and naive, it didn't seem to bother me. I just thought, oh, well, they don't want it. And eventually we ended up selling it, and it was released by Warner Home Video in 1985, and kind of, I guess, launched my career. But don't give up. You know, a lot of the job is the obvious. You gotta have good taste and you gotta be supposedly artistic. But I always think so much of the job is about being a psychologist and just trying to corral people, you know, and deal with the different personalities, because it's a very hard job. And I've been proud of myself because I like to create environments that are a lot of fun to work in. And I like to be the one that eats the stress and everybody else just relax, because it's my problem to make the thing work. I think you have to be very prepared when you're making a movie. I think when you're making independent movies, you probably learn that because you're spending so much time prepping things just to be able to actually have it exist and happen. So prep, being a good prep guy is good. That's definitely what I've spent a lot of time doing, is preparing and re-preparing. And you kind of have to shoot the movies in your mind 100 times before you get on set, because you don't have time to waste. And I do some writing, I do some producing. I kind of got the reputation of being sort of a fix-it director. Sometimes directors will get sick or fired or something, and for some reason I'm on that list of people that they call to, you know, emergency director, fly me in to finish an episode of something that was shot that didn't work out or something. So I think the independent projects that I did, and certainly the stuff that I started when I was at CSIF way back when, was more passion projects. And then it becomes kind of a workhorse job, you know, you're directing for other people. But that's kind of what everybody wants to do. I mean, I would love to just kind of kick back and do my dream project, you know, but I mean, you have to pay the rent. So there's the reality side of the film business set in. But I don't know, I think you can find, you try to transfer your passion onto other people's material when you're doing, you know, episodes and scripts that you didn't write. And I've been really lucky. I've done just such an incredible variety of stuff. I worked for Nickelodeon for years, you know. I've done 5 or 6 kids series. People remember me for the original Afraid of the Dark on Nickelodeon, which I had a blast doing in the 90s in Montreal. And I did the original Goosebumps. I did the original Breaker High series with Ryan Gosling. He used to carry Ryan Gosling on to set when he was 16. It was like, if the director carries me to set, I will go. But that was a blast. Those guys were a blast. And you kind of knew with Ryan that he was going to become something big because he was a ton of fun back then. I mean, I'm proud of everything I've done, but I mean, it's not really my material. It's other people's scripts and things. But in terms of, as a director, I'm really proud of a lot of, I've done a couple of great scary monster movies for Sci-Fi Channel, one with Bruce Dern called Swamp Devil, and I did a movie with Robert Englund called Black Swarm, about crazed computerized killer wasps. They were like bee movies, very tongue-in-cheek, but they were tons of fun to make. And you know, even when you're working for other people and working on other material, you're still applying all the same techniques you learned in at CSIF and all the independent projects you did, because that's how you get these movies done for fairly little money. One of the most fun series I've done in the last few years is a series on vampire apocalypse series called Van Helsing, which is on Sci-Fi Channel in the States, and I think it ran on Space Channel or something in Canada, and it was a riot. Van Helsing was supposed to be the granddaughter of Van Helsing, the original vampire killer, and it was based on a graphic novel, and it was just tons of fun, shot in Vancouver, and I get to be a kid in a candy store again on some of these shows, because you know, they give you all the monsters to play with and all the explosions and all the amazingly cool sets. And I just had a ride on the show. I ended up doing six of them. I did one of the season enders where they introduced this whole new character, and I killed off some major characters and stuff, so it was a major kind of cliffhanger series. But so my existence is kind of very schizophrenic. I'm doing, you know, lighting the Christmas trees and counting down the 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, yay, you know, the Christmas movies, and then I'm also slitting throats on Van Helsing, so it's a dual existence. The TV movies that I've done in the last 20 years have all been 15 days or less. I did one movie with Lacey Chabert for a channel in the States in 11 days. I think that was my record, one of the Christmas movies. And 11 days, it's like, it's not even 2 weeks, you know? So it's, you have to be very prepared and kind of know what you want and what you don't want. And one of the things that was cool for me was working in TV so long is I got a really good handle on the clock, because you only have a certain amount of time during a day to shoot things. And television definitely taught me to watch the clock. I mean, you still want to make a good product, but you realize that if you don't get it finished today, someone else will be directing tomorrow. So there's a hard edge to directing that you learn pretty quickly. I've had an agent now for 30 years. I've got a manager in Los Angeles too, and I kind of just leave the business side to them, which is great. They just kind of try to keep me booked so that they get wealthy as well. Keep me busy, keep the calendar full. But I don't know if you really need an agent to get started. I've often thought, what if I'd made Storm in Los Angeles? What if I'd moved to LA when I was 20? Like, I was gonna go to film school. What if I'd just gone down to film school and made my first feature in Los Angeles? Maybe I would have had a earlier launch pad. But in the 80s, when we were doing Storm, I was kind of the only game in town, which was kind of cool too. You know, big fish in a small pond, so people had no idea what we were doing, because nobody was making movies really back in the 80s, certainly not a lot of independent films. So I think, you know, an agent's important, but I think the most important thing is to just get some movies made, get some short films made, so you've got something to show people. I've had a website for about 20 years that I'm really proud of, www.davidwinning.com, had since 1999. I spent most of COVID revamping it all and putting up like 140 video clips and stuff. So, and there's all sorts of press stuff there about the career. So I guess if anybody wants, more than you'll ever want to know about me is on the website. So that's probably where I would suggest people go. And I'm on Facebook and Twitter and Instagram and all those other things. Cause you gotta keep out there, and you gotta keep your name out there so that people know what you're doing. And I also, you know, when the movies come out, I like to think I'm incredibly good at promoting stuff, because that's what you have to do if you're from Canada. If you're a kid from Northwest Calgary with no way to get to Hollywood, I managed to find a way to do it, but you just gotta keep going and believe in yourself.
Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, light her up!
Guess it's on.
I think we're ready.
You thinking what I'm thinking?
Oh.
we all started. I've got reels and reels of Super 8 film that I did in the backyard. Pixelation of like me driving on the road, you know, like the animated stuff where you move a frame and then you take a frame and you move a frame so you look like you're driving invisible cars along the grass. I have way too many hours of that kind of stuff on film. Maybe I'll show it to somebody someday, but I'm kind of keeping it hidden.
To live, half the time goes by. Suddenly your eyes, another blink of an eye. 67 is gone, the sun is getting high. We're moving on.
I'm really proud of having been one of the original members of CSIF, and I hope that you guys dwarf my career with whatever you guys do.